Let's go. Hi, everybody. My name is Tim Snyder. Welcome to episode 53 of Talkin' Trash. We are live streaming. I don't know what that means or what we're doing. We're just testing it out, but we are recording our episode. So, we have a great guest coming on, Kajsa. She's a good friend of the show, a good friend of mine. You know, the Phillies just got knocked out. Me and Mike are like a wind knocked out of us. Pretty rough. Sorry, Mike. I mean, we're in mourning. Like the Philadelphia sports kills us. I feel better being 700 miles away from it. It doesn't affect me as much. But yeah, it's rough to see that. So yeah, you're watching Talkin' Trash. This is our 53rd episode. We typically record and put it on Spotify, and we get thousands of viewers on Spotify. I don't know what this isn't going to Spotify. This is Facebook and Instagram, and we have thousands of friends and stuff. But I think what you need to do is have a show like on TV, like whatever, Game of Thrones is on at 9 o'clock on Sundays. I think we need to establish that. But this is a dry run. Doesn't matter. Great guest. It'll just be me, Mike, and our guest tonight. It's been an interesting week. A lot going on. Nothing's going on. That was just rhetoric. I'm just hanging out. I'm doing my thing. I'm talking to a lot of people in recovery, a lot of people that need recovery. This show doesn't just stop when the show stops. The work kind of starts when the show stops. Look at my eye. I got shampoo in it. We love our fans. We love the interaction with them. We have the clean time. This show is a blessing to all of us. Let's run through our preamble, and nobody leave. It's like 4 minutes long. I'm sorry. This is the last time you'll see a 4 minute long, or 2 minutes and 23 seconds. This is the last time you'll see a preamble this long. I tried to change it before the show, but I didn't manage my time correctly as usual. So let's get into our preamble real quick here, and then we'll get out of it. This is our humble broadcast, where ethics and personal anonymity are of the utmost importance. We run this podcast as an act of service to those whose lives have been affected by addiction. We don't do it for profit or notoriety. We place principles before personalities. We benefit from this podcast just as much as anyone else. We are transparent about our journeys. We have no expectations or benchmarks set. Our work is in God's hands, who is first and foremost in both our lives and our recovery. It's a privilege to be a part of the recovery community as a mouthpiece for those touched by the disease and who are without a voice. We all work programs and choose to sacrifice our own anonymity to spread the message that recovery is possible. We do this thing in an attempt to show as living examples that no matter how far down the scale we have gone, we will see how our experience can benefit others. Not only is that the ninth step promise, it's our creed we abide by here on Talkin' Trash. We feel called to uphold AA and NA principles. We firmly believe that you can only keep what you have by giving it away. Please join us for a moment of silence, followed by the Serenity Prayer. God, grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, the courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Alrighty, let's go around and meet the team real quick before we get started. First on deck, we got Mike Oxley. Mike is a longtime addiction recovery nurse. He's seen the recovery landscape change over the years, and he brings a colorful component to the show. And here's Garrett Mensah. Garrett's a sober house manager. He's on the front lines every day, and we're lucky to have him sharing his experiences with us. And you got Tim Snyder. I don't know, there's definitely something wrong with this guy. But he's been through it all, and through his experience, he offers solid guidance to those in recovery and those touched by the disease. All right, boys and girls, let's go around the horn and check in with everybody. There we go. Hi. All right. So we're going to check in with Mike Oxley because he's the only co-host we have. Michael Oxley, what do you say, buddy boy?
Hey, everybody. This is live, huh?
Yeah, it's live.
All right, that's cool. Just watch the Phillies just crap all over the season. It's over. Their season is over. Yeah. Now, we knew they were going to the playoffs months ago, but yep. If you're only four games into the playoffs and it's over already.
Unbelievable.
It's something we're getting very used to here in Philadelphia. But on a bigger picture, you know, addicts love bad news. I hope there's no Philly fans out there that are going to use this to drink a little more tonight or buy an extra bag of dope tonight.
No excuses.
It's not that crucial. We should be used to it. So stop using bad news as an excuse to get high and inebriate it and risk your life. That's all.
I overdosed after the Flyers lost in the playoffs to the Maple Leafs in 2017.
See that?
So yeah.
How did I know?
What's funny is I was at my NA meeting or my AA meeting last night, and I realized that when I found out that this was a disease, I didn't get treatment for my disease. I used it as an excuse, like, "Oh, it's not my fault. It's a disease. I didn't do anything." So, like, I didn't realize I did. I forgot about that until we talked about it in the meeting last night. I had a great meeting last night. It's funny. You can read from the big book. It's almost a century old, and it could be written by a female, and it can speak to me. It can talk to me, and it did last night, and I was so surprised. I'll share some of that in a little bit. Let's see. What else?
You know what's funny? This particular group that you're a part of for AA, your home group that you talk about, like, you know, they're the same people, and you say sometimes, like, oh, these people are idiots. I can't stand
it. Don't say that. I don't say that.
It's like family is what I'm saying.
I got a lot
it's
of people
like them. Where you've had enough of them, you're up to here with their rhetoric, and then you can have a nice time the very next meeting, and there you are.
Uh-huh.
You're saying how nice it was.
I'm sorry.
That's all I'm saying.
Step. All right. Yeah, I know. We're all people. People piss me off. I'm in a bad mood. I don't like you. I don't like you.
Right, like family. Right.
It is. We're a family, kind of. Good core of it. There's probably 10 of us that are. It's a great meeting. I'm so lucky. It's 5 minutes away, 3 days a week, same people, same place. I used to jump around meetings and, you know, hate this one, like this one. This one's torture. But this is such a blessing in my life. I never expected this. And, you know, what a great thing. And we read this thing. It was written by, I want to say, Sylvia B. or something like that. It's called The Keys to the Kingdom. It's on page 268 of the big book. And we're reading it. And I'm like, what the hell? She is describing me. And she's talking about herself. I didn't think it was written by a man or a woman. It was just a human being. It was crazy how it connected with me. So people always say, oh, it was written in 1939. You know, it doesn't apply today. People are people regardless, whether they're in 1939 or here, whether it's sedatives and barbiturates or fentanyl or whatever. So, like, you know, we live in a very very difficult time with this fentanyl thing. And that's most of what we talk about is the fentanyl awareness and Narcan. And, like, Narcan is the only thing we have other than a podcast to say stop gambling with pressed pills and stuff. You know, so we say do Narcan or have Narcan ready. And, you know, it's unbelievable that people are still dying that don't have to die. People look at, oh, they're just drug addicts. They overdose. They died. You know, people that don't have any compassion for addicts. You know, that addict may have recovered if he was revived. You know, so we're not bad people. And we're certainly not worth life. Like, we deserve, everybody deserves a second, third chance. That's life. You know, I believe in a loving God, not a vengeful God. And I believe one that forgives and everybody should be like that. And it, you know, that's just a PSA from me. People are people. I'm a jerk sometimes too. You know, I'm not perfect, but yeah, you gotta, attitude is everything. Isn't it,
Yeah, I mean, you know, clean time. Let's just take clean time, for example, is one of the more popular portions of our show. That's people at their best. But we care about them at their worst, too, by the way. As people are watching that clip, they're thinking the best for these people. But there's been people on there and currently on there that have been as high as they are and have also come to us and said, listen, guys, I'm disappointed in myself. I didn't mean to disappoint you. And they didn't disappoint me. But they're starting over. So that kind of accountability is pretty special bond we have with our clean timers. And they're not perfect. But, I mean, we hype them up because they deserve to be hyped up.
Yeah.
You know, they don't have a boss doing it, but they may not have family doing it. But here's two guys, or with Garrett, it's three guys that give a hoot. And they need to know that we do give a hoot.
I give two hoots, not just one.
He gives two hoots.
Yeah, I go. I got all kinds of hoots over here. I'm ready to give them all out. Let's see. I don't know. All right, so listen to this. This is crazy. This happened to me today. I'm looking for contacts. I don't have contacts in. I can barely see anything. I can see my computer screen close enough. So I'm looking for contacts. I'm going through my old stuff, and I come across this, right? Let me explain what this is. This, when I used heroin, I used a contact case. Very smart thing to do. I would fill it with water. I would put the cotton in there. I would use that to mix my heroin with the plunger of the needle. And I would do heroin. So this just shows you, the one on the right is just dirty from old heroin. You know what I mean? You take a look at that. I took a look at it today. I actually got kind of nauseous. I was like, ugh. Like, that was what I was, you know, putting in my arm. You know, I would get the bag, Starbucks. I would take a piece of cotton out of a cigarette. You fill up the contact case with water. You use the cotton. You draw the needle. You see that blood go into the needle, and it's like, I have dreams about it all the time. I'm not telling people how to do heroin. If you want to do heroin, there's plenty of things online to tell you how to do it. This is just my experience, and that's my contact case that I used 1,000 times to fill up my needle. So it's just crazy. I found that under my sink today, and I think
you might want to wash that out, buddy.
I don't. It's not. Please, I will. I threw it out. It's in the garbage.
Oh, good. There you go. Even better.
You know, there was a time in my life where I licked my finger and. Even though it looks like dirt, and it is dirt, it's
probably... Now, being on the subs, you know that it wouldn't do anything, so why? You
oh, yeah, I mean? That too.
You always know in that it totally works for you.
That too.
I mean, it really does.
I'm such an addict, you know what I mean? I really am. I don't hide that. I'm built that way. I don't know why. I didn't make me, but yeah, there's the subs help. Yeah.
So one of our clean timers, the reason I brought up clean timer, is going to be on our show later, on Andreas? Our very first.
Who?
Andreas
Estrada?
No, Kajsa.
Oh, Kajsa. She is on our clean time segment, and she will be on in a few minutes.
Right.
Yeah, you know, I just want to touch a couple things.
So that's why I brought up the clean time people and what we're trying to get out of it. Now we can get into her business, which is a little expanded beyond clean time, and how she helps the whole recovery community as well, since she has started her recovery. But she's best to talk about that, I would think.
Yeah.
Well, as I'm watching the Mets celebrate right now,
turn it off, Mike.
I can't even watch it. It makes me sick.
Just turn it off,
but
Mike.
You know what? We did it to ourselves. We did it to ourselves. So
you play for the Phillies?
Well, you know, I always take people make fun of me. I always take my gloves still. Thinking that they might need me, they might sign me.
Wait a second. Let me get this straight. You wear a Phillies jersey, right? I'm sure about that.
Yeah, right here.
Official jersey. Mike, yeah. You walk into Citizens Bank Park with a glove on your hand?
Yeah. And it's my jersey.
Oh, no way. That is stitched. That is not a cheap jersey.
Because I am not being treated.
At least
by my own name.
At least you're not showing us your ass crack. You're just the last time you turned True. Around and you know, jersey was.
Oh, that was my gun, right? I remember my gun.
Oh, yeah. You remember? Yeah. So just so everybody knows, Mike has a, you wouldn't believe it, but he has a tattoo of a gun on his left ass cheek, just above it.
It's not my ass cheek. It's my lower back, like it's in my waistband, dude.
All right. Well, you showed 3,000 people your ass.
I'm always packing is my point. I'm always
Episode 40. No, what was it? 30? Oh, no, it was 30. 30 was ridiculous. I should take that off the internet because that was just insanity between the three of us. Yeah, but you showed your ass, and I'm sad I don't have a clip of that.
It wasn't my ass. It was just a gun. It's a Glock.
You didn't mean to, but you pull your pants down and you show 3,000 people. You know, it's going to happen. Anyway, there's a hurricane going on again.
Right now,
Tampa, that whole area. You know,
I've been following this Lieutenant Dan. Does anybody know what I'm talking about?
Not at all.
It's a guy
I'm the only one here.
Oh, yeah. 20-foot sailboat tied up to a dock, and he rode out the last one, which was Helene, and he's riding out this one. The mayor of Tampa actually went down there today to speak to him. So did the chief of police, and he's going to ride it out. He believes through he must be a physicist along. He's an amputee also. Mm-hmm. He reminds me a lot of I don't know. He reminds me a lot of some patients of mine. Anyway. Everybody. I think he likes a little bit of the drink over the years and probably a little bit of smack. But he's missing a leg. He lives in a sailboat. And he happened to make it somehow on the last storm, but it didn't hit Tampa Bay directly like this one is going to do.
Yeah.
So Lieutenant Dan, they call him, I guess, calls the leg thing, remember?
Yeah, clearly.
He believes that simply by tying up to this high pole, that if the water rises, thus will his boat rise. So he has no problems, no reason to fear.
Well, what if his boat capsizes? I mean, does he have a plan for that?
He said he slept through the last storm. Don't worry about him. I saw that a GoFundMe has started for him, and it's already up to close to $30,000. So good for you, Lieutenant Dan. And they pretty much, again, have told people that are not evacuating right now to write their name and their birth date and social security number on their arm so their bodies can be identified. Now, if that doesn't wake you up.
Yeah, no kidding.
To get out of town, I don't know what else is going to wake you up. And I saw some people dropping off dogs today and on the highway as they were leaving town and tying them the telephone poles and fence posts along the highway.
I'm sorry.
Along the highway. They were tying them and leaving their pets behind. And the pets kind of knew and were like, yo, come back. Hey. And
is that normal? I mean, that sounds awful.
No, it's not. And it breaks my heart. You know, I think I do better with seeing humans tied than I just don't kill a dog because
I'll
doesn't
straight
fit
up.
Your car. You know
I'll
what I mean?
Straight up murder somebody. I just I'd stay in Florida with the dog, honestly.
I could handle blood and guts as a nurse. I could not as a vet nurse or vet tech. I'll tell you that right now.
Yeah. So I'm looking on Facebook. I don't know how any of this live stuff works. We've been recording for 6 months or 8 months or whatever. I'm looking on Facebook. I just see the event. I don't know. I don't see where you watch it live.
I think everybody that is our friend gets a notice that we are live right now.
Yeah.
Everybody that is that page's fan or subscriber maybe should have got a notification that says Trash Dash.
You're getting there. Almost. Trash Dash Podcast.
Is live right now. And then you click on it and they're watching me right now. But you got to be it just doesn't go out to the world. You got to be a member or something. Maybe there'll be a way to do our personal names, our pages, and tie them in where everybody that is our friends could also know that Trash That Podcast is live streaming right now on Facebook, I think. Is that what we're on, Facebook?
We're on everything. Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. We're streaming to like 5 different places.
MySpace.
Yeah, Twitter. MySpace. I had a MySpace for a long time.
Green Day, woo!
Green Day. But yeah, I get alerts from people I don't even care about saying they're going live. I don't even know them. Why don't we have that? Anyway, our hearts and prayers go out to the people of the Tampa area, St. what is it?
Petersburg, Sarasota.
Yeah.
Sarasota is really taking the right outside of Tampa Bay. Yeah. There was like 23 million people affected by this. Yeah. And again, it's not so much the storm initially that'll be through by about 2-3 in the morning. It's the surge of the water afterwards.
Yeah.
And the next couple of tides. So this is where we're going to see if Lieutenant Dan, who is also bizarrely called himself Noah a couple times today. But hey, whatever works for you, Lieutenant Dan.
Attaboy. The government is creating these storms with their. Have you seen that shit? I've been reading some of that just for
fun. If they
could
do that, why not put some rain into the desert? I mean, come on.
Well, yeah, they say they're controlling the storms, they control the clouds or whatever. The earth is
the flies off the Ethiopians' heads.
Yeah, you know, the earth is flat. Water. Oh shit, it's 20 minutes. We got things to do here.
All right.
Real quick, I watched Cocaine Bear and Meth Gator. Cocaine Bear wins in a fight. I just decided. I'm a big fan of Cocaine Bear. He didn't do anything wrong. You know, guy dropped
a bunch of protecting his stash. Yeah, what he found.
Yeah. Meth Alligator, I'm just not into it. I watched half of it. I couldn't get through it. So
although they're tweaking tonight in Tampa, but
oh, no doubt. So yeah,
unless Lieutenant Dan can hook him up.
Yeah, that's true. I'm sure he's got a stash. Anyway, if you want to waste 4 hours of your life, watch Meth Gator and Cocaine Bear. Let's get into October birthdays real quick, and then we'll get going. All right, friends and family, it's the beginning of October, and it's time to celebrate this month's birthdays. Happy birthday to Aria, Lucia, and Justy, Bethany Casimir, Robert Vargo, Kelly Altman, Chris Woods, and Tara Dixon, Mike Oxley, Deshaun Booker, Haley McDermott, Cache Odell, Trudy Gibson Horner, and Jessica Calabrese. Alex Petrine, AJ Hamilton, Tim Snyder, Sarah Cobney, Benjamin Seymour, and Ronnie J. Let's not forget Travis Kelsey, Eminem in recovery, John Mellencamp, Matt Damon, Paul Simon, and Zac Efron, also in recovery. So happy spooky October birthdays. Not only is it your birthday, but it's another day you celebrate alive and sober. Stay safe this Halloween. No extra party favors. Yeah, so Halloween is upon us. How about that? It's October, Mike.
Hey, do you know what's funny about that birthday list?
Yeah.
Four of my best friends in high school, we were all born within 4 or 5 days of each other.
Weird.
Isn't it really weird?
Really
so,
weird.
Like, in a small town, four of my best friends, we were all, I would say, 23rd, 20th. Yeah, within 5 days of each other. And I still talk to them today. Finally, somebody, like, not until we were seniors, figured out how to use a library. And they went in and found the old Farmer's Almanac.
Mm-hmm.
Farmer's Almanac. From 1969. And since we were all born this particular week in October, they look back at the weather of February 69, and there was a blizzard.
Right.
The five of us guys and girls, we're still in touch. We're all blizzard babies.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if you have the same parents. I wonder how that goes.
I don't know.
I thought that's where you were going with it. I was about to ring.
No. It's a real true story that that week of the 19th through the 26th, me and four of my best friends growing up had the same week birthday.
That's funny. October awareness. Let's take a look at that real quick. A lot to be aware of.
Freaking dark, man.
It is rough. So let's take a look at the October awareness. National ADHD Awareness Month. They're super aware. They're aware of everything.
They forgot everything.
No, they're on. Yeah, they're on Adderall. National Down Syndrome Awareness Month. National Physical Therapy Month. Pregnant and Infant Loss Awareness Month. Spina Bifida Awareness Month. Sudden Infant Death Syndrome Awareness Month.
Isn't that the same thing as pregnancy and infant awareness? If it's sudden infant death, There's two maybe different weeks.
Maybe they could combine the two and get some more.
I don't know. You would think.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't even know why we do this this bit here. But
usually because there's a funny one. I don't see one funny one.
No, nothing funny on here.
Like World Hot Dog Relish Day or something.
I would put like International House of Pancakes Day, but Mental Illness Awareness Week, that's me. Malnutrition Awareness Week, ridiculous. World Cerebral Palsy Day, that was 2 days ago. National Depression Screening Day, and whatever the last one was, it went off. So, yeah, it's just a strange strange awareness thing. We were aware because of Recovery Month last month. It was all kinds of awarenesses that applied to our show. But this one is strange to me. I just don't get it.
Maybe because we're on the recovery boat. We're on the recovery ship or the recovery train, where I didn't think any of those days were out of line or ridiculous or dark.
They were good.
See, maybe because we're part of that. We looked, we took pride in each one and, made them individual. You had your own little stuff for each one. It was very well choreographed us to get through the month, by the way.
Thank you. So, yeah, I don't know. It's, we're like, I did like, I was just trying to fill time. We were just building a show. So we do birthdays, we do awareness. I have a 10-minute preamble. Maybe we'll, start cutting this stuff down and get into the meat and potatoes of things because we are, off and running here. We have serious stuff going on. All right. So I would say, why don't we bring on our special guest? I'm excited. She's gonna be tight. All right, let's welcome to the show a good friend of the show, Kajsa. Kajsa's 62. She's a philanthropist. She resides in Houston, Texas. She's been sober for 4 years now. Way to go, Kajsa. Her drugs of choice are alcohol, cocaine, benzos, opiates, MDMA, and psychedelics. I think that's every drug ever made. She operates recovery Facebook groups. She's an ambassador for Sober Hope Houston, and she loves a good laugh here and there, which is why she'll fit in here nicely. So welcome aboard our friend Kajsa B. Quite an intro.
Hey, Kajsa. Quite the intro, I would say.
I can't hear. Oh, you're muted. What a great start to the show. How great. Hi, Kajsa.
Hi, Mike. Hi, Tim. Thanks for having me. Oh, that was awesome. I love the intro and the song. Yeah.
I listened to Details, and you said something about the Pearl Jam song, so I put that up there.
Yeah, that song, I needed to hear that song right at that particular moment in my life.
Yeah.
He does Details very well, but also had you muted.
I can't listen.
That's a small detail.
I'm the dumbest smart person you'll ever meet. I can remember every I can remember every license plate I've ever had, but I can't remember I put bread in the toaster till I smell it burning. So I have like ADHD to an excessive extent. So anyway, we got the show going. It looks nice. It's fun. We got a great guest here. Kajsa is I put philanthropist. I just like that word. But I think you are a philanthropist, is someone who is involved and gives back. So, like, Mike, did I label her right or wrong? Did I overdo it?
Yeah, I think so. I like a lot of people know Kajsa from her clean time when she's on our normal clean time segment. But I'm excited for everybody to kind of ride along in her story. And she can tell her story as much as she's comfortable with.
Sure.
But I want everybody to remember something when she tells her story. That Kajsa gave it all of it up, right before COVID-19. So here she is sitting at home with, what am I supposed to, and did not relapse, which I'd really like to know what she did differently than just living her life during that segment of time, that initial February, March, April, May, those first few months of being sober, being that in December, right before the holidays, she had decided to quit all drugs. And she used a lot of them. But I don't want to take any away from her story. But there has to be another story within the story about the COVID stuff that went on.
Now, but, Kajsa, tell us your story. I took notes when we talked yesterday. 2 pages worth of notes, actually. I think the best part is here where it says looks great for her age. And I have your name spelled out phonetically because I'm an idiot. So you have the floor, my friend. Walk us through it.
All right. Well, okay. My name's Kajsa, and I'm an alcoholic and an addict. And my sobriety date is 12/9/19, and for that, I'm truly grateful. So a little bit about my background. My name is from Sweden. My mom is Swedish, and my father is American. He's also black, and my mother's white. So I'm the product of a interracial marriage. Mm-hmm. I do have an older brother. So my parents got married in the very late 50s. They had my brother and then me. And at about 3 years old, we moved to the Virgin Islands, and where my parents ended up divorcing. And my dad married a woman from Puerto Rico who I considered my stepmonster because she was very evil. Mm. My mom moves away to Boston. I end up going to Washington, D.C. with my dad and my brother and my stepmonster. And, I suffered abuse from my stepmonster. Mm. I never understood why. I don't know what I could have possibly done, as a small child to this woman. Anyway. So, my mom ends up after, I don't know how long, I was, 3-4 years old. My mom comes and gets me and my brother, and she takes us back to, Boston, Massachusetts, where she was living. And she, at the time she was dating this, professor of mathematics, Dr. Richard Greachy, we were with them for a while, and then my mom told my dad she wouldn't send us back to him. So, I just thought of this. My dad decided that he wasn't going to send any money for support because he wanted to get the kids back. Well, because of that, we were forced to eat duck eggs because my mom said that after she paid the rent, we had $30.
Eat duck eggs.
Yeah. So, and here's my dad, worked for the government. Made, plenty of money to be able to take care of his kids.
Respectable wage, sure.
Yeah, right. So his kids can eat, and have to eat duck eggs. Anyway, we ended up moving to Manhattan, Kansas, because my stepfather got a job at Kansas State University. And that's where I grew up. My mom and stepfather married right when we got there. So I was in first grade. So my stepfather's Italian, and Italians let their kids drink. Mm. So I was able to have a little taste of wine with dinner. And I did, for I don't know how many times, but several times I had a little bit of wine with my dinner. But, I don't ever remember making me feel any different. Right. At the age of 10, was having a slumber party, and my parents were having a party, and they came in my room and said, "Kajsa, you want to smoke the peace pipe?" I was like, "Sure.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah. I don't know what it is, but okay.
Yeah, I'm in.
Sounds like the thing to do, So I smoked some weed with them, and I don't remember that making me feel any different either. Mm. They were loving parents. They were cool. My mom was very lenient because she was from Sweden. She, she's very different than the American parents of my friends,
Well, it's a neutral country, so they don't get involved in much.
Mm. Well, yeah. And she didn't really get much involved with me either. She just let me do whatever I wanted. Really. She always said, "Well, I think you have enough sense to come out of the rain." I'm like, "Oh, that's great. Thanks, mom." God, I just lost my train of thought. She was a flower child, hippie. They were, my stepdad had long hair and he had a PhD in mathematics. He was on the Mensa Society. He was so cool. They were so cool. They really were loving, loving, loving people. So at the age of 14, I'm in, junior high, and a lot of people gave me a hard time because they called me a half breed, Yeah. Oh, well, maybe you don't, but anyway, so and but I found my group of people, yeah. And we would drink. So the first time that I drank, when I remember it changed how I felt, I was 14, and there's like six of us packed in a car, and we're going to the drive-in movie because that's what you did back there in the 70s. And we had a bottle of bourbon, and you know, everybody starts passing it around. When it came to me, I just grabbed it and I just hit it, and I hit it hard. And I had about like 10 chugs. And I remember the burn, it tasted gross, but I just held my nose. I was like, yeah, mm-hmm. I like the way that makes me feel. That was it. And so, you know, I mean, from that point, thinking back, when I drank and was all the time, I only drank to get drunk. It was never a social, you know, let's go to happy hour and have one. No.
Yeah.
After that day. And I got sick. Threw up, passed out, had a hangover, all kinds of stuff. And I could not wait to drink again. Mm-hmm. And so here I am, junior high, and basically we just did the same thing. And then we started, with the drugs. Basically, you name it, whatever, you know, back in the 70s, what was cool. And we could actually afford to get, because we were teenagers. But I mean, we did crazy stuff like siphoning the gas out of a lady's tractor and putting it in my friend's mom's car and going joyriding.
Yeah.
And I don't know why we did it or how we did it, but my friend hotwired the tractor and we all jumped on this tractor, and there's probably about four or five of us. And we rode this tractor around this lady's farm out there in Kansas. It's fun. Anyway. Yeah. So, you know, I didn't get in trouble for drinking underage. We had a family stash at home where we all smoked pot together. Perfect. I smoked pot with my stepdad and his professors, math professor colleagues, me and my 14, 15 year old friends, nothing weird, just smoking weed. I mean, that was it, And, my mom would say, if you're going to drink, come home and drink, so you're not running around. Well, of course we did that anyway. Mm. So, okay. So, this basically, that was just my life, well, it wasn't my life, but every, on the weekends I drank up through until like once I graduated from high school. When I was 17, my mom gave me permission to move out of my house and move in with my boyfriend, who was 7 years older than me.
17? Oh my God.
He was 7 years older than me. Yeah. And he rode a Harley, and he was a wonderful, wonderful human being. He really was. He was a good man. He bought me my first Harley. It was a 1962 45 flathead, which is the same year I was born, 1962. And I rode that thing to high school to my senior year, which that year I actually had perfect attendance when I didn't live at home.
Wow.
When I lived at home, I skipped out all the time. I don't know. Anyway.
Well,
yeah. So, I was with him for about 2.5 years. And then I decided I was too young. Once I, graduated high school, he wanted to get married, yeah. And I didn't want to. And I knew I couldn't marry him because I didn't want to make him miserable, right. Because I knew I didn't love him like that. And he was too good of a man to have, to have that in his life. So I gave him back his motorcycle. I did,
Yeah.
And he ended up marrying the next gal that he dated after me, which is great. He's still married to her today, which is a wonderful thing. Good thing I let him go. I'm just kidding.
No kidding.
So then I went to, after high school, I tried to go to college. Yeah. I managed to like make it to my volleyball class for about 2 months, and then I dropped out completely.
Yeah.
And then I went to cosmetology school.
Oh,
well, that was fun.
Yeah.
And so that the party just ensued after that, because I grew up in Manhattan, Kansas, and the university there is Kansas State University, and they have this place called Aggieville, and it has all the bars and everything in it.
Yeah.
And it's right next, it's like right across the street from the campus. And so we would go down to Aggieville and party, and there was this one place we'd go on Thursday nights from like 7 to 8, they had 3 drinks for the price of one. And then from 8 to 9, 2 drinks for the price of one. So we'd go in there and just drink as much as we possibly could.
Sure.
Beat the clock night. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And, you know, I just remember doing that. It was just crazy. Then I had, it was a small town and I wanted to leave, you know, I wanted big. I wanted something different.
Sure.
No, I mean, we never even locked our front door, you know, growing up.
Did you graduate beauty school?
I did.
Okay.
I became a licensed cosmetologist.
Beauty school dropout. Okay.
I was not a dropout.
My daughter went through that.
I mean, it was fun, but once I actually cut hair, I didn't like it. Matter of fact, when I came to Texas, I even got my license here, and I worked for a little while, and I was like, just, you know, no.
Yeah.
Brief. I mean, for about 3 months, I'm like, nope, I can't do this. I wanted to come to Houston. I came down and I visited my mom, and I decided I was going to move here. So I went back to Kansas, carried on a little bit, and then, let's see, July 27th, 1982, I packed my car. Everything I could get in it, a 1972 Oldsmobile Cutlass Supreme, and it was turquoise blue, and it blew smoke.
I was born 3 months later.
All right. Right on, man.
Thank you.
and I drove down here to Houston, and I remember eating a bunch of speed for the ride down here.
You have to.
Yeah. Because it's like a 12-hour drive. That's if you go straight through.
Right.
So my mom was in Sweden at the time, but she had a little duplex right over in like Mexican town, which was great because, you know, I could speak a little bit of Spanish. And the little girl next door would bring me food. I loved it. It was great, you know. So anyway, I ended up, you know, I remember driving down the street. Richmond. And I'm like, well, I'll just stop at some restaurants and to start filling out applications. First place I stopped at, I got a job as a hostess.
Mm.
You know, time went on. I met some other people and they, you know, got hired on at a supermarket. And then I was working. I got an apartment. I mean, a job as a leasing agent. So I did that for about 7 years. But then, you know, I wanted to go to school to become a nurse, but I had this fear of failing because, you know, the step monster that I had that I talked about earlier, she always told me that I was, you know, I was dumb and I was stupid and I was ugly, that I would get pregnant and, you know, all this, you know, she said all these horrible things to me and I didn't understand it, you know? So I had this horrible fear of failure and you know, so one way for me not to fail was to do what I do best. So go get a job in a bar. And at the same time I went to school and I, you know, managed to put together a degree in science, but it took me about 8 years to do it. So I really liked bartending because there I was right there. I got the booze. I got all the booze in front of me, behind me, everywhere. I'm in control of the people at the bar. You know, don't act like an ass or I'll cut you off. And I did.
Sure.
I'm like, I'm God. I'm God behind this bar, you know.
And people buy you shots. Give me one. You take one. You know.
You know it.
Of course.
Yeah, absolutely. Tip me.
The territory.
You know, Coke in the tip jar. you know. So
yeah, the 80s, right? You're right.
My kind of tip.
Yeah. So and we did all, you know, I mean, we did all kinds of crazy stuff, you know, staying up for 10 years. I remember staying up all night long, sleeping all day. You know, get up and go to work, just rinse and repeat. 10 mm-hmm. years. The money was great. The drugs were good. The alcohol was great. I had so many friends because everybody knew me because I was a bartender. And I mean, I could go anywhere and get in for free, you know, me and my entourage or whatever. But you see, I drank all the time. I mean, there was probably, I mean, if a mild week would be where I drank four nights out of the week.
Mild week.
That's mild.
Yeah.
Anyway, so my 10-year high school reunion, I went back to Kansas, and my brother had told me he wanted me to meet a friend of his, which I remember from high school, except for, you know, I rode a Harley, and he was a cheerleader, so yeah. Plus, I had a boyfriend.
He was a cheerleader?
Yeah, he was a cheerleader. He was a big old burly guy cheerleader that used to throw the chicks up in the air. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Look at their skirt. I don't know. I'm sorry. I went home for my reunion and I met this guy, and I mean, it was like, we just looked at each other and it was just on. And, he ended up getting a job down here in Texas, and we started a relationship, and we decided I would move back to Kansas. And, so he was on January 9th, 1991, he and my brothers, were coming to get me. And on their way here, Kevin got killed in a car accident. My brother, was belted in asleep, so he was fine. But I didn't know it when I found out that there had been an accident. Now, I had come home from work at lunch, and that was going to be my last day there. I had an answering machine because back in the day, that's what you had. And it had one blink. So that meant there was one message. And I just knew something was wrong when I looked at the light. And, it was my mom telling me that my brother and Kevin had gotten into an accident. And she's like, don't do anything. I'll be there in a minute. And, I didn't know what happened, but I remember asking God, praying to God, whatever it was I did. I said, look, if you take Kevin, I'll be okay, but please don't take my brother. And, you know, then I find out that Kevin did die and my mm-hmm. brother was alive. So, I remember calling a couple of friends to come over, and I had these little buttons on my phone with the phone number, you know, programmed into it already.
Speed dial.
Thank you. Yes, that thing. And so I remember calling my friend Leela, and she's like, well, what do you need? And I said, well, I need Valium and beer. And she said, okay, I'll be over. So she came over with the Valium and the beer. And some other people came over. And now Kevin was in really, really good shape. And he didn't really drink at all. I was the big drinker. Yeah. But he was also an organ donor. Well, a friend of mine that came over worked for an ambulance service. And the day that Kevin died, one of her coworkers flew to the hospital where he was in Wichita, Kansas, St. Joseph's Hospital, and picked up a heart for a recipient. Mm. So,
wow.
I do believe that was his heart, you know, because they have to do it right then and there. You know, they can't, it's like you can wait a few days.
Can't wait,
Yeah, anyway, so it's taken me a long time. I do think that was God letting me know that Kevin helped somebody live. Yeah. So, you know, when you think about it that way, it's your perspective, you know. But I did. I drank for about 3 months straight. I hit it hard. Yeah. And after, I don't know, maybe 3 months or so, I thought to myself, you know, he would really be pissed at me if he saw what I was doing to myself. So I thought I'd, you know, cut back on the drinking. So, you know, I cut out one night of drinking a week.
That's good.
Anyway, yeah.
Good start. You were drinking every day at that point?
Yes, for 3 months straight after his death, yes. Okay. And then I rolled it back to, you know, four nights a week, five nights a week, whatever. So I worked in the bar restaurant industry for a long time, but as I got older, I realized I needed to find a job, a day job, a straight job, as we call it. Mm-hmm. And, there was a lady that came and sat at my bar that dated the owner, and we had about a 3-year conversation before she asked me to come work for her. And she owns a marine transportation company. And, she asked me if I would come work for her. She's like, you know, you really deal with the customers really well. I'm like, well, you know, I cut them off. Mm-hmm. You know, I can tell them, I can cuss them out. I can do whatever I want, you know?
Yeah.
Anyway, I can't really do that to your clients. Anyway, yeah. So I went to work for her and, I worked both jobs for a while. So, you know, basic, same crazy stuff. Staying up all night, or, you know, getting 2 hours of sleep, going to work, you know, just feeling like death warmed over.
Yep.
And the one thing about that job is people used to keep like bottles of vodka in their desk. So, you know, I could go do a shot or something if I wanted to. Normally I would go, oh, I just feel so bad, I don't want to drink again. And then, you know, okay, give me a couple hours, I'll be back at it. Right. So I'm going to cut up to 3 years before I quit drinking. Which would be somewhere around 2016. I met this guy and I started to date him. I started to date him. He didn't really start to date me.
Yeah, he wasn't aware.
So, you know, he was definitely one of us. Yeah. And he a narcissist. And I had never really dealt with that before in my life. So my answer was to just drink every day, you know. And, you know, trust me, my life was already way out of whack, you know, just an insert dickhead. And, even worse.
You were telling yourself you're going to drink to be easier with him, to be more, or to get over him, get past him.
Just to get through his shit.
Oh, I got you, yeah.
And, you know.
To cope.
Yeah. Thanks.
Got it.
Yeah. To cope. And, you know, after, I don't even know how long, a year, maybe something like, I don't know. I finally just said, look, let's just be friends. I really can't do this. And, of course he's like, oh, okay. But, you know, he wouldn't leave me alone. He kept freaking showing up here at like 3 or 4 or 5 in the morning. And, you know, hi.
They could have stalking.
Exactly. And I would go places and he would be in there. I'd be in a bar and he'd show up and all this crazy stuff, you know? And I finally ended up, I would get all these crazy ass text messages and he, you know, I was just like, God, what? Just leave me alone, you know? But he didn't want to do it until, I guess it was his idea. I don't know. Anyway, so, I'd changed my phone number and all that. So eventually he kind of left me alone. So comes a time when I'm going to get my blood work done for my general practitioner.
I was going to say, do you have any liver issues? Like,
well, yeah. Yeah. So my general practitioner sends me to a liver specialist. So see, I did know I had a problem, but I just didn't know how to stop.
Yeah.
And I, you know, many times I just won't drink today. Well, no, I couldn't even not drink for an hour.
Right.
And I knew I had problems. I knew it wasn't right. So I went to see this doctor, but I really had no intention on quitting. And I walk in, and a friend of mine was with me. My friend, who her sister was Leela. And so, but this girl, her name, just call her G. G sober. Now, I've known G for 40-something years. And we ran the gamut. But she got sober about 5 years before I did. And I watched this drastic change. But anyway, so I go to the doctor with her, and he's like, no, this is liver specialist here, big guy in Houston. He's like, you have to stop drinking or you will die. And, you know, he said some stuff. I didn't really listen because I had no intentions on quitting drinking.
Yeah.
And that night was her nephew's birthday. So I told her, oh, well, I'll just drink tonight and then I'll quit tomorrow. Mm. I had no intentions. Now, you know, my eyes were yellow and I had gray skin.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I didn't quit. A few weeks go by. I end up missing work for a week because I couldn't get out of bed. I mean, I just felt like I was going to just die, but I could manage to run to the corner store to get some more booze and then just come home, lay in bed all day.
Yeah.
I missed work for a week. My coworker came and got me. She looked at me and she's like, get your, you know, I'm taking you to the emergency room. And I said, okay, sure. But hang on, let me get all this booze. So put all this booze I have in a bag. I'm like,
take it with you to the hospital.
I took every bit of booze I owned in a bag with me to the hospital.
Yeah. The only alcohol in the hospital is a hand sanitizer. So I get it.
I probably would have drank that if I'd have had a clue. Anyway, so yeah, they admitted me there, and I was in for the week of Thanksgiving 2019. I was in the hospital. 2 days before I got out, I ran out of booze, and my hands peeled, and the bottoms of my feet peeled. I couldn't really sleep that well, but I mean, I didn't shake, I didn't sweat, I didn't have any of those kind of withdrawal symptoms. My friend comes and gets me. I immediately. When she drops me off at my truck, I immediately went to the corner store and got some more booze. Mm-hmm. And I kept drinking. I ended up having to go back. This is like a month later. I got to go back and talk to this liver specialist. And so my friend went with me again, and I walked in, and he's like, you know, you have to stop drinking. You are going to die. Mm-hmm. And my friend says, well, tell her when she's going to die. Tell her how she's going to die. He's like, I can't tell her when. He said, but I can guarantee it's going to be very slow and painful. So, yeah. So, you know, he's like, you know, you should go to rehab. I was fighting it. I was coming up with all these stupid excuses why I couldn't go. I couldn't miss work. And my friend's like, well, what kind of job are you doing there now? Cause you're drunk there every single day. You know, I had been drinking like every single day for the past 3 years. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so I finally decide I'm going to go to rehab. I have to tell my boss. I'm thinking, oh, they're going to freak out, you know. And when I was sitting in my chair at work, I saw my boss start to walk up the stairs. And it was like something pushed me out of my chair to go tell her. So I ran up there, and I just knew she was going to say, oh my God, what's going on? But when I told her, she's like, oh, that's good. And I was like, oh shit.
Yeah.
Oh, what does she know?
Yeah.
Everybody knew.
We're always the last person to find out that we have a problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The lies we tell ourselves. Mm-hmm. So anyway, her mom, who is the owner, who was the lady that I had the conversation with all those years ago,
that was the bar owner. Right.
She's still my boss today.
How about that?
Yeah. So that's she took funny. Me into the warehouse, and because that's where we smoked cigarettes. So she took me into the warehouse and she said, don't worry about your job. Go take care of yourself. Get well, come back. Don't worry about anything. You know, you'll get paid while you're gone and all that. I'm like, oh, well, God.
Ahead of time. Right.
Yeah.
If I knew this.
Right. Had I known this, I might not have turned yellow on everybody and gray. Real quick. When I was in the hospital, I took off my gown to take a shower. Yeah. And you know how they have those huge, huge mirrors. And I saw this. Okay.
What body part is that?
That is a bruise on my stomach. It's the size of a plate.
Oh my God.
Did you figure out what caused that?
I didn't fall, but that was from my drinking.
Oh my God.
The liver.
That's my crazy. Liver telling me.
It's like.
I'm it's moving.
Like reaching through the skin, like trying to send you smoke signals.
Right. Yeah. Right. And I had bruises like that, you know, and on my arms, on my legs, on my stomach.
Oh my God. You didn't have DTs when you stopped? You didn't shake or anything, you said?
I didn't. Wow. I didn't. In the hospital, I did not.
Well,
now,
you did go to rehab, so they medicated you, obviously.
They gave me phenobarbital for the first 3 days.
Right, okay.
But in rehab, my hands peeled, the bottoms of my soles of my feet, and my head peeled.
I'm not familiar
with that. Well, you're like a snake. You're shedding your addictive coat. Your addictive skin and getting a recovery coat of skin.
Well, I love the analogy, but what's the physical? I'm new to that. I've never heard of skin peeling. I don't know what that is.
You know, I don't know because there was one person in rehab that said that they had had something similar happen to them, like their hands peeled.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious. It would have to be something to do with some of the vitamin deficiencies. Why the body responds to the lack of or to the damage is running to the liver as in xenobiotics, something like that. But I'm curious enough once we're done here to look it up.
Tell you what, I go to my doctor next Friday. Yeah, next Friday I have an appointment with Dr. McFadden. So, and I'm still under this man's care. Actually this month is 5 years I've been under his care. Anyway, so I go to rehab. I decide I'm like, I don't give a shit. I'm not gonna fight with anybody. I'm gonna do whatever they tell me. I'm gonna just stay to myself. I'm gonna mind my own business.
I'm gonna jump in real quick before this isn't a topic anymore. I'm reading online right now. Since alcohol is a diuretic, it means it causes the body to release more urine. It leads the body to lose more water and salt than usual. With less water in the body, it's easier for your body to dehydrate. Dehydration can negatively affect your skin, causing it to dry out and peel. So it's dehydration is what it is. Or at least Dr. Google says it.
Well, there, Dr. Google. Well, I tell you, when I was in the hospital, they put me on a special kidney diet. Oh, that sucked. Anyway.
Yummy.
Dialysis was probably next, but go ahead.
Yeah. So I go to rehab and I do what I'm going to do. Cause I'm like, I don't want to. And I watch all these people running around hooking up with this one and that one. Yeah. And I'm like,
rehab romances.
Yeah.
I've had three.
Yeah. They didn't
end well, believe it or not. I don't know.
None of them did. It was a match made in heaven.
Yeah. Well, I remember one of the RAs asking me, well, who do you like? And I'm like, what? She's like, who do you like? I go, like in here? And she's like, yeah. And I go, I'm not here for that.
Yeah. Two dead batteries don't start a car.
Yeah, right. I remember while I was there, you know, my counselor is a wonderful dude. They kept saying, you should go to AA. And then, of course, in the classes, we would read the big book, and then other people from different groups outside would come in and talk to us while we were there. And, you know, they're like AA or NA or CA or one of those A's, you know.
Some kind of A.
Yeah, it was. The day I got out, and I also went to IOP because they had, when I went to rehab, they had that all hooked in together with my exit.
They usually do.
Yeah, that was great stuff. So the day I got out of rehab, I found an AA group that was closest to my house because I did not want to drive very far. Yeah. So the day I got out, and I got out of rehab January 7th, 20, I drove down the street. It's 5 miles from my house, just like you.
Yeah.
And I walked in and to this day, I still go to that group. But I did what they said. I got a sponsor. I worked the steps. I honestly, thoroughly, fearlessly, all that shit. Make friends with the other people there. You know, do ever. I just did whatever. I did whatever they told me to do. I didn't care what that was. I'd have done it, you know. And I had the day when I really realized that things were changing. I was about in the fourth step somewhere. Between 4 and 5, I'm not exactly sure where. I went to the Circle K to get my coffee, where I go every morning. I stepped out of my truck, and between my feet was a bag of cocaine.
Mm.
Or at least it was a white substance. I mean, it could have been anything, you know.
Well, yeah. I mean, dreamer. I got a story that, like that. Go ahead and go. I'm sorry.
It's okay. So I picked, I immediately, I was like, shit. And I picked it up and I threw it. And as I let go of it, it just went like this, slow motion.
Yeah.
I was like, and I watched it. I was like, what the fuck was that?
It's funny. Yeah.
And so I had to call my sponsor and say, you know, she's like, oh, that's a program. Yep. She goes, the obsession's been lifted. I was like, oh, Jesus Christ, something's going on here.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. So.
That's incredible. As addicts, we all seem to have that moment where it's like, you know, like something happens, like it's different for everybody. Some people, it takes breaking your neck in a car accident. Some people you can, well, like you, for you, your liver, you know, you got to a point.
Oh, it was life and death for her.
Right. But in recovery, especially in a fellowship, you know, you start to see life differently and start to see people differently, and you want what they have. For years, I went to AA and I was like, I'm not like you people. You know, I'm different. I'm unique. You know, I'm worse than you. You know, and I was missing it. It was right in front of me. It's sad. But that's amazing. You went to AA and you found a sponsor and a home group and people that took you in. Yeah. And now here you are. And if AA wasn't there, you wouldn't be here. I'm sure of it.
I don't think I would.
So but almost just, 40 years of drinking and stuff.
43.
Yeah. Now, I was trying to be kinder.
But who's counting? I don't care.
Yeah. Listen, who's counting?
During your recovery and as you, the doctor and all that, what did you do to work on the mental aspect, the damage that was done? Because I heard you mention your stepmother even years ago in the 50s and 60s. How did you put some of that to rest? Was that contributing to your drinking? Yeah. Was there some emotional damage that you worked on?
Good question.
Well, I mean, yeah, that is a great question. Well, what I did was when I did my fourth step, it took me, I don't know, maybe a month and a half to do. And when I started writing, I thought for sure, y'all know what a fourth step is.
Do I ever.
Okay.
Fearless, so I start writing. Moral inventory.
Inventory. So I'm writing everybody's name who wronged me, right? Sure. I got my step monster on there.
Their fault.
Everybody's fault.
Mm-hmm. Was she still alive at this point or no?
I don't know.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
She'd be in her 80s, right? She would have been
She's young. My mom's 84. She's younger than my mom, so she's probably about 80. Okay. So you see, my sponsor and I worked on this thoroughly, and you know, I was able to put it to rest, and whatever happened, it wasn't my fault. Right. It had to do with her.
I've done 4 fourth steps, and all the first three were, it was blaming everybody. It wasn't looking at myself at all.
Yeah. Well,
that was me.
I've done one that is a mother load. Mm. That was the mother load.
Yeah.
And I've done several small ones after that, you know, had a couple of people on there,
it's not your fault. It's not your fault, especially as a child, 2 years old, 3 years old, for your dad's Puerto Rican chica. You know what I'm saying? It never was your fault. You know that now.
Right.
You do know that now, of course.
Absolutely. And
Did you ever get married? And you never had children?
No, because why would I want to ruin a perfectly good human being? Fair enough. I can do that to me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and I, you said. know,
Did you feel like with the nursing that you would fail as a mother? Did you feel like you would fail?
What I worried about was, well, you know, this little thing that I'm going to have to take care of, and I know I'd love it. Kid, you know, whatever. I'm gonna have to feed it. I'm gonna have to give it a house. I'm gonna have to clothe it. I'm gonna have to do all this stuff. I'm gonna have to give it my attention. That's gonna take away from my drinking and doing drugs.
Selfish, yeah. Right? Unselfish thing to not to have a child. Unselfish thing.
I thought, well, you know what? I don't want to fuck a kid up because I probably would, and I don't want to be a single parent because I probably would. Yeah. You know, Kevin died, so I'll
right.
I was like, I didn't even want any kids.
Yeah.
You know, I love kids.
Dogs were your kids? Yeah. I should have had more dogs than kids, you know?
Yeah. There was a point where I told myself they're better off without me. And in the state I was in, that was true. You know, and I told Mike about my girlfriend that I lost. He's like, good for her. Way to go. Because she needed to get away from you. And that's perspective.
Yeah, she did need to get away from him. Sure. And, you know, we can read between the lines of your story. Those are home and are junior official psychologists. And we can figure it all out like true crime shows on TV, watching you just on their phones. You know, I think that stepmom did a lot of damage. I think you took your mom's blasé European indifference to the whole be your own child. Well, this ain't Sweden. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It's the big bad America. And I think you took that as not caring. And I think she cared the best she knew how. And the way her mother raised her, which was probably post-war over there. Not that they were involved in it, but there was a lot of flack coming from World War II in the 40s before she met your father. And, you know, I mean, there's a host of things, but that all made you who you were. You know, sure. It all made you who you were. And thank God you're a different person now. But I mean, now you're giving back. Tell me about your ambassadorship with the Hope thing.
Okay. So, Sober Hope Group on. Oh, look at there we go. We have different states. So I'm in Houston. Well, that's Texas. But we have an Austin page, we have a Connecticut page, and in Connecticut we have a big deal going on Saturday, Faces of Fentanyl. It's a free gathering, whatever, event, thank you. So, and we have other pages like in New York, West Virginia.
Are they all doing the same day? Is it a special day, or did it just happen to be their?
No, their just day? This is what's going on in Connecticut.
Okay.
Yeah. And I manage whatever admin other sober pages.
Okay.
Now this group here is very small. We're just growing. You know, trying to just connect people is what we want to do. You know, I mean, a sober page, kind of, it's like all the same stuff repeated over and over and over. Mm-hmm. You just try to jump in and give people support where you can.
Yeah.
You look like the kind of person that would be monitoring these pages and being an advisor and administrator of these pages, but would get attached to the story and worry about them. And, you know, that's hard to do when you don't know where they're coming from. You can't put eyes on them, but it is still rewarding. Have you ever reached out outside of the page and helped somebody?
Well, you mean like on like send them a text message or something? Or
yeah.
Yeah.
I've seen people on the page. They've said something and I'm like, like I know somebody they can talk to. I know somebody in their area. Yep. Above, you know, they'll ask for a reference. You know, I need something in, you know, Canada or whatever. Yeah. And I got people all over the place that I know. And, you know, I'm like, I send them a text and I'm like, I got a person here and I need to send them your, you know, I need you guys to talk. And so I've done quite a bit of that.
That doesn't surprise me with you and your personality that
yeah.
you would kind of go above and beyond, even with the administrator of some of these self-help pages that are supposed to be anonymous, that you would identify yourself and say, here's my number. I got somebody you need to talk to. That doesn't surprise
me.
With your
we're all doing the same thing.
Good for you. Good for you.
Thanks.
In different ways, we're just, we're all doing the same thing. Yeah, that's admirable. For a long time, I didn't want to be in addiction anymore. I didn't want to work in it. It was just too much for me. And doing this podcast, I kind of chose to step back into it because that's what you have to do to keep what you have, you know. And
you have to give it away.
Yeah.
You have to. And I just wanted to touch real quick on the COVID part.
Oh, because right. Here you say everything and then you're sitting home.
Yeah. I'm newly sober, right? And I was scared. I'm like, oh gosh, am I gonna relapse? Because I hear all these people talking about relapse, and I'm scared. I don't want to, you know.
The only things that was open was a liquor store,
right? Yeah. You know,
they couldn't
close
them. The only thing open, that was crazy to me.
Luckily, I am essential worker, essential worker.
Okay.
So I had to go to work. I didn't have to work all day, but so at that time, you know, they came up with Zoom.
Right.
God bless Zoom, because I got involved in Zoom.
Yeah.
Right. And we're kind of doing the same thing right now, you know, in a way, Texas, Georgia, and New Jersey right now. So, that's good. And you had to look your best and be coherent to do that. And you felt people were watching you. You know, if you're going to preach, people are watching, you know.
Yeah.
So that's a good guide. So
that's how
you use COVID not to bring you down. You use it to make you accountable. So that's good to hear.
And that's how me and Kajsa found each other, just through her outreach, her doing stuff. I wasn't nice to her.
I texted you, too.
You did? Yeah.
I reached out to him.
I was early on with our podcast, and I'm putting it everywhere, and people are taking it down. And I'm like, I'm not advertising anything. I'm trying to help people.
Yeah, so, we're like a nonprofit. We're not making any money here.
But this is early on. We got 50 people watching this. And, you know, her page... You know, it automatically took my post down, and I send her a nasty message because that's what I did back then. I would never do that now because we're like a company almost. But like, yeah, I sent her like a message that was like, "Oh, I guess you don't want people
to help each other."
Yeah, way to go.
And then
it's
the
only your kind of help. Yeah, it's only your help.
Oh, I get it. And then she writes me back. She's like, "It was automatic," and she was sweet about it. And I felt I was convicted. I was like, "I'm such a dick." So anyway, look, we're friends and we're spreading the word together, and
definitely.
I think that's great.
Yeah.
So let's do some clean time, Kajsa.
Kajsa.
I know. I know. I'm so ridiculous.
Kajsa.
Here we go.
Am I doing clean time?
Yeah, of course.
All right.
What you do?
Hey, Hallie McDermott. Look at that red tag. 33 days. Proud of you, kid. Skylar S. 35. She's got her tag. The worst is over. I'm lying, but keep working. 60
John
days.
John Brown,
you're awesome. Look at that tag. Valencia. 62. How's it feel? This is real time now. Katarina D. 67 days. That's pretty impressive.
That is.
April R. 70. That's a lot. 73 days from Monica Fontanello.
Monty Fonny.
Michaela Booker, 75 days. One of my personal favorites. Mm-hmm. 77 days is Frank Kenny still with the mirror glasses.
Hey,
look creepy. Rico Denya, 82 days. I can smell 90 coming, Rico.
I can smell Rico.
83 days, Ronnie J, my man.
Alex, one more.
Alex, look at that. Going to be 90. And he found us in a rehab. Samantha S., you're awesome.
90.
Almost ready for that winter hat. 96 days for Anthony Fields. He goes up. He went back down. And look at him again, people.
Yeah.
100 days, Destiny J. Hey, there's our old friend, Daniel G. 106 days. Proud of you, Dan.
Good job, Daniel.
AJ Hamilton, 111 days.
My boy, AJ.
That's real time.
Andreas,
that's real time.
That is.
112 days.
New guy.
And Levi W. He's one of our newer ones, but we're all on board with 118. And our original fan. The first fan we ever had, David D. He's awesome. 130 days for Christian A. And Tim, Tara, and Dixon. Look at them two.
Now, they are not
they
in
are
a
cute couple.
They're not in a relationship.
They're not, but they should be.
Okay.
133 days, Alex M.
Hi, boy.
133 days from my own personal story, Nikki Starnes.
Girl.
We were so new at that time.
No.
136 days, Stevie Crikey's W.
I talked to Tony J today and told him.
How is Tony?
He's all right. He's fine.
164 days from Maria. I'm so glad. Jen, I'm on your segment. 170 days, Jen. 176 for Jared Black.
A boy.
Can't believe it. And there's Kissy Face Mandy Jean. 206. That's no joke.
That's
207
good.
For Jamie Michelle. That's a little bit of perfection there.
Yeah.
And my man, Deshaun Booker. Wonder if he's related to Michaela. 236 days.
Oh, yeah.
Ricky McVicker. 256 lap days. However we cut it, it's a lot, buddy.
My
311
friend.
Days. Vouvez-vous avec moi. C'est soi. 311 days, Aunt Patty.
I
love that's you,
good,
girl.
That's a good band.
313 days. Craig, see, and still a creepy hoodie.
Look at Tommy. Tommy Wilkes.
1 year. Congratulations, Mr. Tommy Pants. And we know Will. 368. Out of Will. Got a year last week. We had a previous engagement. And 566 days. College show. Let's assume you're 665. Hey, Amelia Quarto, 2 years and change. 2 years and change for Stella Montez. April Pritchard, 3 years and change. I think it was August when you switched over
to
spring.
It was.
Jeffrey S., my man. The beard.
7 more days.
Kajsa. 7 more. Kajsa B. Kajsa B. 4 years and change. Lisa Welke, 6 years and change.
Our boy.
Simon Frost. Hey, my man, 6 years. Check out his site, will you? 8 years, our own personal favorite. Tina C. 8 years and change.
There he is.
And Matt Gillespie. We were talking about him earlier. 12 years and change. Neil K, 13 years and change.
That boy, Neil.
Hey.
Hey, Mike, who's the most important person in the room, Mike?
The one with the that brings Keurig.
The
Jeffrey
newcomers.
Newcomers. 13 days, Bridget Shades.
Shades.
16 days for Jason D. My man, proud of you guys.
Boy.
All right, Keith. 23 days. The first month is the toughest. Proud of you four guys. Thanks for letting us take the journey with you. We're proud of you so much.
Do it, Mike.
Tim at Trash Dash. podcast.com.
Yeah.
Get Narcan. Don't forget about 988 if you're in trouble or know somebody in trouble. Find us on one of our various outlets for our wealth of information. And that's the clean time for today.
Mike mentioned 988. We need to acknowledge 988. It's also Suicide Awareness Week. It ends today. So, you know, act now. If you have a guy or a gal who's suicidal and you don't know what to do, they may not even be hurting themselves. They might have said things like suicidal ideations. Oh, I wish I wasn't here. And if they're using drugs, that is multiplied exponentially. So no reason for anybody to take their own lives, especially with drugs, because you're taking your own life under false pretenses. I suck at life, so I'm doing drugs because of that. Nope. You suck at life because you're doing drugs. Like, it's, you know, what came first, chicken or the egg? Chicken did. So, like,
well,
it's the same thing with everything.
Being that I can't work as a nurse anymore, obviously, like, I would do that. Like, I would do that hotline. I would do a few hours a day. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
but I've already been inappropriate, as Tim likes to say. So I would have to watch being my appropriateness for the, you know, kill yourself hotline thing.
I don't think that's what it's called. Kill yourself hotline. Good job, Mike.
Oops.
Yeah, no,
That's not what I meant. That's not what I
know. It's not what you meant.
I thought I would be good on that thing, you know.
Wow, this show went quick. It's an hour and 25 minutes, which I'm fine with.
Wow.
But keep a low.
Wow.
Well, it's live.
It is.
It's not using up our tape. It's not using up our tape.
Nope.
Or storage, because it's live.
True. Well, I do. You have no idea what the storage and the video.
It was a pleasure getting to know your story. And you look so healthy. And you look 15 years younger. And you're doing great. And keep reaching out and doing what you're doing. And you're a friend of the show now officially. Tim's going to send you a shirt, I'm sure, right?
Yeah, I'm running out of shirts to send people. Oh. I'm sending them my own shirts. Yes, I will send you a shirt for sure.
Well, thank you so much for having me. Oh, it's an honor.
It was a blessing to have you on. And Garrett couldn't make it tonight because apparently he's working in a subway.
Driving that train, not high on cocaine.
Yeah. Eating lo mein. I just came up with that. So anyway, we had a nice show here tonight. Great story.
Our first live. How'd it go?
I don't think it's live, to be honest with you. I looked everywhere. It says live. I don't know. Whatever it is, 53 happened, and it was a great show. Kajsa was awesome. Is there anything else that you would like to leave us with? Miss?
I just want to say, if you're struggling, reach out. Chase this thing. Chase your sobriety like you did the dope man, and don't quit before the miracle happens.
Without a doubt.
And I tell you what, because they keep on happening. Mm. It will happen over and over again. And life is so much better being, free of mind-altering substances.
Yeah.
Just reach out, please. Please, because you don't have to do this alone.
Places like us, Talking Trash, Kajsa and her groups and what she does for the Sober Hope, there's so many ways to reach out now. So there's really there's no excuse like, oh, I didn't have the resources. I'll find your rehab. I've done it like 15 times already.
Yes, we have. Yep. Yes,
you know,
we have.
And I don't know you from Adam. I 3 o'clock in the morning, a guy called me. Telling me he's going to kill himself. I'm on the phone until 6 a.m. and we're getting him into a treatment center. So,
I told you it was called Don't Kill Yourself, see?
The Don't Kill Yourself hotline, yeah. So, anyway, there is so many resources and ways to get advice, get help, people that have gone through it. It's a different world now. Dual diagnosis, mental health is huge.
Big part of it.
I wanted to talk to Kajsa about that a little bit too, but we're running out of time. But mental health for me, if you don't know my story, I take Suboxone. I take, this is my med case. Like, are you kidding me?
Oh,
but
wow.
I've addressed my mental health for the first time in my life and stable, and I'm happy for the most part. And, I try to send that message out there that maintenance isn't a bad thing. It saves lives better than fentanyl. Taking a Zoloft every day is not a bad thing either. I mean, and you did drugs for how many years? You rewire your brain, it's not firing like it's supposed to be. There's ways to even that out. And those things are widely available now where they weren't years ago. So there's mental health, there's Facebook groups, there's podcasts, there's all kinds of people out there bigger and better than us that you can reach out to. But we're blessed to the people that have reached out to us. We're blessed to have met people like Kajsa, because now they're friends of the show. Like we have 15 or 20 of those people that we've had on, and now they're friends of the show, and we connect and we help people together. And it's just a blessing to be able to give back, because I never gave back. I always just took, and I always relapsed. And, why didn't I get this thing? I was sober. I had it all figured out. I was taken. I was never given. And I was, I'm in a position now where I can give back. Mike is too. And and you devote all your time to helping people. So you're always welcome on our show. That's for sure.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Kajsa.
Before we get out of here, let's read today's Just for Today. What is today? October 9th. Just for today, titled Order, page 295. It is from, hold on one second. too loud. Sorry. We emphasize setting our house in order because it brings us the least. Well, that's true. The basic test page 97. Focus on what others are doing can provide momentary relief from having to take a look at our own selves, for sure. But one of the secrets of success in Narcotics Anonymous and Alcoholics Anonymous is making sure our own house is in order. So what does setting our house in order mean anyway? It means we work the steps, allowing us to look at our role in our relationships with others. When we have a problem with someone, we can take out our own inventory to find out what our part of the problem has been. Problem for me for years. With the help of our sponsor and the fellowship, we strive to set it right. Then each day we continue taking our own inventory to avoid repeating the same mistakes in the future. Daily inventory. It's pretty simple. We treat others as we would like to be treated. You know, we promptly make amends when we owe them. And when we turn our lives over to the care of our higher power on a daily basis, we can start to avoid running on self-will, which is characteristic of our addiction. Guided by a power that seeks the best for everyone, our relationships with others will surely improve. And that's scripture right there, for sure. Just for today, I will set my own house in order. Today, I will examine my part in the problems in my life. If I owe amends, I make them. And that we were just talking about that, right? You know, everybody else's fault, not my fault. Then there's a problem. Now I look at my part of it. What did I do wrong? And it's easier to do that when I'm honest and I'm an open book and I'm able to do that. So yeah, that's about it. Long show, great show. Kajsa, thank you for coming on. We really appreciate you and what you do in the community. You know, reach out on Facebook, people. You know, she's great. Get in touch with her. She's got a lot to offer. If you need to find her, contact us. We'll put you in touch with her her group pages. And yeah, thanks to everybody that supports Talking Trash. We love you so much, and we'll see you Sunday. I get no time.